Too much work, too much stress, and not enough sleep. Sound familiar? Many of us are living that life, and unfortunately, it could be having serious impacts on our health and our relationships. So how do you keep the daily grind from grinding us down? Well, it turns out timing may be everything. That's one of the messages of the new book, Energize, which explores how we can all use our body's natural tendencies to improve our health and our lives. And I'm delighted to welcome the co-author, the sleep doctor, Dr. Michael Breus, back to Frank Buckley Interviews. Dr. Breus, it's good to see you.
Great to see you, Frank, and thanks for having me on the show again. I so much enjoy your company, and these podcasts are awesome. Your interviews are incredible.
Thank you so much. I have to say, you always look like you've had a good night's sleep. And I wonder, do you have better sleep than most of America because you know how to get that better sleep?
To be fair, I definitely kind of know when a bad night is coming, and I have a very good idea of how to prepare for it. But I'm a human just like everybody else. And here's the bottom line. If something's going on with one of my kids, I just don't sleep so well, right? You know, you kind of get that whole thing going, that monkey mind going, and you can't stop thinking about those things. But as a general rule, I keep my sleep super consistent, and that allows me to have super high quality sleep.
So that's you today. Not getting enough sleep obviously can have serious impacts to your health, to anyone's health. And you yourself, I was surprised in reading this book, had an incident that was life-threatening and in part because you weren't getting enough sleep. Can you tell our viewers and our listeners about that?
Yeah, so part of the impetus for the book were there were two, I guess you could call them heartbreaks. My co-author, Stacey Griffith, I was working with her on her sleep, and her and her partner of the time made it very difficult for her to sleep. And so she kind of lost her partner, not in the physical sense, just they ended up separating. One of the reasons having to do with sleep. So she had sleep detriments due to a broken heart. I had kind of the physical heart issue. I was unfortunately at a restaurant one evening, and what ended up happening was I was really running myself too hard. I was traveling constantly. I was working out everywhere I went, which all sounds like an okay thing to do. But, you know, when your travel changes your schedule and you're 2 hours behind and you're not consistent and things like that, you just try to get it in where you can. And unfortunately, Frank, I was really burning the candle at way too many ends and ended up on the floor of a restaurant and then in an ambulance to the hospital. You know, it's very interesting going from being a doctor to being a patient in about 6 seconds. And it was quite scary, to be honest with you.
And part of this book is about not just sleep, but health and exercise and diet. And your co-author is Stacey Griffith, a master instructor at Soul Cycle. And we'll get into that in a moment. Yep. But let's talk a little bit more about sleep. And one of the things we've discussed before is your research on chronotypes. And I think it's important for us to sort of reestablish that with our listeners and viewers so they understand where we're coming from and what might where they might fall in all this. And we've got a graphic on the screen. It says the basic chronotypes. And we start with dolphins, lion, bear, wolves. Take us through it. What is a dolphin?
So first of all, I want to take one step backwards and describe to people what a chronotype is in general, and then I'm going to go through each one of these, if that's okay.
Sure.
So a chronotype in general is this idea that we have a genetic predisposition for a sleep schedule. Now, you may not have heard the term chronotype before, but you've actually heard of the concept. So if any of you or your friends or your family has ever been called an early bird or a night owl, those are chronotypes. My contribution to the literature was I came up with a fourth chronotype. So if you look at the graphic here, I also renamed them because I'm a mammal, not a bird. And I decided to change things around a bit. And so my contribution was, as we know, there have been early birds, I call them lions. There have been night owls, I call them wolves. And then there were people in the middle, which we call bears. But the most interesting contribution was this idea of dolphins. And so it turns out there is a genetic predisposition for some people for insomnia. And these are people who are kind of a little on the anxious side. They kind of, I say, vibrate at a higher tendency. These are the people that you see that are shaking their foot during the meeting. These are the people that are a little bit on the chatterboxy side. These are people who've got a decent level of anxiety. Highly intelligent people, by the way, highly motivated people. In many cases, they're very similar to our early birds, or what we call our lions. But unfortunately, the anxiety can get a little bit in the way. Again, the lions are my early, early risers. These are people that get up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. To be clear, there's only one thing that I hate more than mornings. That's morning people. You guys are just way too chipper for me, okay? I am a night owl. I'm a wolf. And so for me, that's not my realm of morning for sure. Next come the bears, and they have a tendency to get up around 7:30 in the morning time. Believe it or not, it's the best to be a bear. I kind of wish I was one, because all of society is built around a bear's schedule. That 9 to 5 really works well for bears. About 50% of people turn out to be bears. Night owls, I call them wolves. That's me. I am a night owl for sure. Rarely go to bed before midnight. And if I had my druthers, I wouldn't wake up until probably 8 o'clock if I had that as an option. So, you know, those are the four different categories. And if people are interested to figure out what their chronotype is, we'll have it in the show notes, but you can go to chronoquiz.com.
And so that's part of the backdrop that I want to establish here. The other part is our body types, and you've set up different body types that we should think about when it comes to this new book, Energize. Take us through the body types and what how they relate to all of this.
So this was very, very interesting. So I'll tell you a little bit of the backstory as to why we started to look at body types. And when people want to thinking about body types, you need to think back to like high school biology. Remember, you were learning about the ectomorph, the endomorph, and the mesomorph. So these are the body types that turn out to be really important. When I was meeting with Stacey and we were talking about our different types of people that we work with, she uses exercise and bases it on people's body types. You can see from the graphic here, an ectomorph is kind of a long and lean person. A mesomorph is more of a V-shaped kind of person. And an endomorph is a little bit on the thicker side. And so what we discovered was this has a lot to do with metabolism. So one of the things that Stacey and I decided to do is we said, look, we've had 1.5 million people take the chrono quiz to learn more about their chronotype. I wonder if there's a relationship between chronotype and these three body types. So we actually sent out a survey to about 5,000 of my followers. And sure enough, they filled this out and we started to learn even more about this whole process. And so knowing your genetic body type and knowing your genetic chronotype actually gives you kind of the keys to the castle for better health.
So let's having that as a backdrop, if I am sort of, I don't know, let's just pick the one in the middle, that I'm neither the sort of the lean.
You're the bear.
I'm the bear.
And a mesomorph.
I'm a mesomorph. And my wife is a tiny person and, right. And our schedules don't always mix. And I think this is happening more and more in society because of our work schedules, and all of that. How do we mesh our lives? Should we be sleeping in separate rooms? Or is there a way for us to sleep together soundly?
So the answer to the question is yes, you can sleep together soundly, but you may have to do a little bit of compromising or a little bit of things beforehand. And so as an example, if your wife, I think you said she's an early bird, maybe has a tendency to want to go to bed early, where you might want to go to bed a little bit later than her. So there's lots of options to do something in that realm. Number one, you don't have to go to bed at the same time as your bed partner. I want to be very clear, that doesn't say anything about your relationship. A lot of people say, oh, well, if you don't go to bed with your bed partner, that means that you're not going to be intimate, or you're not going to be caring, or you're not going to be as loving, these types of things. Honestly, nothing could be further from the truth. This is a genetic predisposition for a sleep schedule. But you do want to spend time with your partner and you do want to enjoy that time. And so being able to come to some compromises, as an example, if the early bird likes to go to bed, let's say 8:30, 9 o'clock, well, then maybe the night owl says, okay, instead of watching TV from 7 to 8, which is a normal occurrence, I'm going to go and spend some time with my partner because I know they're going to be going to bed earlier. Or maybe you go and read a book while your partner falls asleep. And then once they fall asleep, you can go into the next room and do something else. But the good news is you don't have to have what we call a sleep divorce, just because you may have different chronotypes. And especially if you have different body types, that's okay too.
There's not much I can do about my body type. Obviously, I can exercise, but it is what it is. But can I do something about my chronotype?
Unfortunately, you can't. Chronotypes are genetic, and these are things that are kind of built into our DNA. I will tell you, however, they do change over time. So if you think about it, babies are lions, right? They go to bed early and they wake up really early. Then when you get into that middle school toddler range, they become a bear, going to bed around 7:30, waking up around 7:30. Then you get to high school. High school is a whole wolf environment for sure. I don't know about you, but my kids like to stay up until 2 and sleep until 12 the next day. Yeah. Then your chronotype seems to set for about 30 years. Then when she hit 50, 55, I'm 53, and I'm starting to notice a few changes, you start to actually change chronotypes. And sometimes you seem to get a little bit earlier. Mm-hmm. So as a night owl or a wolf, I'm probably going to start changing more into a bear or maybe even a lion as time goes on. So the good news is you get to kind of try them all out, but usually that 30 years from about 20 to about 50, it should be pretty stable.
All right. This is all good information. You've also designed what you're calling a power protocol to help us feel more energized with the proper amount of exercise and sleep. When we come back, we'll ask the sleep doctor to take us through it. And welcome back. Let's get back to our conversation with the sleep doctor, Dr. Michael Breus. He's the co-author of the new book. It's called Energize. You've created with your co-author, Stacey Griffith, the Soul Cycle Senior Master Instructor, something called Power Protocols. What are they and how will they help us?
So what you do is you figure out your body type and you figure out your chronotype. And when you put these two together, you get what we call a power profile, meaning you're a fast bear or a slow dolphin or something along those lines. Once you discover that, then we actually give you power protocol. So what is a power protocol? A power protocol is an overall program of intermittent fasting, sleep, and movement, not necessarily exercise per se, but movement to help keep you consistent, balanced energy all day long. And so they're personalized, right? Because we want to make sure that we understand your metabolism. We learn that from your body type. We understand your chronotype. We learn that from the quiz. And then we use these tools in order to create a personalized program of, again, intermittent fasting, movement, and sleep. It's pretty cool.
It is. I was really surprised at how all of those sort of work together to affect, because you are the sleep doctor, my sleep. I didn't really think about diet and exercise in that context. And also some of these right. exercises, when I learned that your co-author was with Soul Cycle, I thought, oh man, that's going to be a big workout and it's going to, but you're talking about little things like 2 minutes of jumping jacks in the afternoon and that sort of thing.
Exactly. And you know, one of the things I want to be super clear about is this book, we designed it very specifically so that everybody gets the opportunity to participate. You know, one of the things I really learned from Stacey was she looks at people's body type and then gives them exercises to do. So as an example, if you're an endomorph, you're a little bit on the bigger side, nobody should be telling you to go out and do a 10-mile run, right? Because you're not going to succeed. You're not going to enjoy it. You're going to lose that motivation. That's going to decrease your energy. So we're finding exercises, stretches, things like that, that can increase people's energy. We came up with a program, actually Stacey did, called the 5 and 5. So this is 5 times during the day for just 5 minutes, you will move. And we have very specific movements that you do throughout the day. Is it okay if I break it down?
Absolutely. And let's go.
About the 5 movements?
Yeah.
So the very first movement, when you wake up in the morning, everybody's going to do a stretch. kind of makes sense, right? You've been lying there for a while, kind of stretch it all out. I don't know about you, Frank, but I'm 53 and every morning I think I need a stretch. That's the first one. That usually comes in around breakfast time. Then just before lunchtime, we have people do a shake, right? So shaking your arms, flapping your arms. You ever notice animals, when they wake up, what's the thing that they do? They stretch and then they, you know, they do that crazy shaky thing that they do. I just did it and it kind of woke me up. Like, it's unbelievable, right? That whole shake really kind of just kind of resets your energetic movement and allows you to kind of rethink through things. After lunch, you would do a bounce. So that's what you mentioned before. And this is not a big bounce. A couple of jumping jacks, being able to skip. It's pretty funny. My wife makes fun of me. She's like, "You're skipping down the street, Michael." And I'm like, yeah. And I'm having kind of fun with it too. Like, I mean, my neighbors think I'm crazy, but I'm pretty sure they thought I was crazy beforehand. So I'm not as worried about that part. But the jump or the bounce is very fun and energetic. The fourth category is a build. And so this is where you use a major muscle group. So maybe you do some push-ups, maybe you do some sit-ups, some squats or deep knee bends, not to break a sweat, just to really kind of get your body up and get your body moving. Remember, sitting is kind of like the new smoking, right? We don't want to be sitting for time and time and time. We got to get up and start to move those things. And then the final one is a balance. And so we have people, you know, doing like a tree pose in the middle of right before bed, things of that nature to, again, get you more centered, get you calmed down to be able to get into bed. And again, these are not exercise routines. You're not gonna turn into somebody that's super fit by doing these, but you will turn into somebody that has consistent energy all day long for all of the pursuits that you may have.
You talked about intermittent fasting before, and I was reading it, and that always is one of those terms that intimidates me. And I think, well, I like to eat in the morning, and I like to eat in the afternoon, and I like to have something for dinner. But I was surprised. You're talking about if I can just stop eating from 7 in the evening until 9 in the morning, I'm going to get some sort of a benefit. And that benefit is what?
So the benefit turns out to be more energy based on something called autophagy. So one of the things that we know is if the system, your body is the system we're talking about now, fasts for a particular period of time, you burn through your carbohydrates, and then your body starts burning fat. This is very, very important. Now, what's interesting here, what we've learned are two specific things about intermittent fasting that I don't believe has been out there before. Number one, I'm an intermittent faster. I've been one for about 5 or 6 years, and I do it based on my chronotype schedule. Many people don't do that. Many people just say they pick some hours, not based on their genetic body. So number one, we now know when to fast, which is kind of unique. That's not something that people have talked about before. But now that we know that your body type, we actually know how long you're supposed to fast for. So if you remember the body types again, ectomorphs are our long and lean people. They've got a pretty quick metabolism. To be honest with you, Frank, we don't want them fasting for long periods of time because then they're going to lose more weight than they actually need to lose. So for our ectomorphs, they'd have 12-hour fast with a 12-hour feed. Our mesomorphs, those are kind of more of the muscular type or more of a V-shaped body type. Those people are a little bit different. We let them feed for only 10 hours and fast for 14 hours, right? Then the final ones are our endomorphs. These are our people that are a little bit on the bigger side, and many of them do want to lose weight. So we actually have them fasting longer for 16 hours and feeding only for 8. So what's great about this is it gives you a starting point of how long do I need? Because, you know, there's a million different intermittent fasting schedules out there. So this actually dials it in and personalizes it based on your body type. And then when you do it is based on your chronotype. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. And just so we're clear, we're not talking about going on a diet here. That's not what this advice about. This is about keeping your energy levels consistent throughout the day and then helping you to get to sleep at night. All right, we're going to take one more short break. When we get back, more with the sleep doctor, Dr. Michael Breus. And we're back with the sleep doctor, Dr. Michael Breus. And Dr. Breus, you and I have talked about this before. You are the most popular guest at every dinner party. Once people find out that you're a sleep doctor, they have questions. What are the most popular questions that you're asked? Please share those answers with our viewers and our listeners.
So first of all, thank you. It's true, that definitely happens to me. And so there's three big questions that I often get asked. One is, what bed should I buy? The second one is, how do I turn my brain off? And the third one is, what do I do if I wake up in the middle of the night? If people want to know what bed they should buy, head on over to thesleepdoctor.com. There's lots of information there. I even have a mattress buying guide. But when we're talking about this inability to fall asleep or stay asleep, I want to give everybody a few tactics that they can use tonight if they need them. The first one is called 4-7-8 breathing. This was originally developed by Dr. Andrew Weil. It's been used by the Navy SEALs, but it helps lower your heart rate. Many people don't know, but the one thing you want is you want your heart rate to be at 60 or below in order to enter into a state of unconsciousness. So for folks out there, you breathe in for a count of four, you hold it for a count of seven, and you breathe out for a count of eight. By breathing out longer than you're breathing in, you dump excess carbon dioxide, which makes your heart work less and lower that heart rate. Another big one that I tell people all the time is to count backwards from 300 by threes. I know it sounds a little silly and nobody said there was going to be math today, but the truth of the matter is it's mathematically so complicated you can't think of anything else and it's so doggone boring, you're out like a light. So I would say think through those ideas. And of course, if you want to learn more about sleep, check out my new book, Energize, because there's lots in there about that as well.
All right, great. I'm glad you got the pitch in. And let me share that the picture of the book once again with our viewers. The book is Energize. It's written by Dr. Michael Breus with Stacey Griffith, who is a great trainer and gives us the exercise diet portion of giving ourselves energy and better sleep. We're going to continue the conversation on the audio podcast. Dr. Breus, thanks for joining us on TV, and thank you for joining us here as well. We'll see you next time.